Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to another episode in the series The Cross Questioned. And today we're going to look at why the body was anointed. When this body is lying in the tomb, why do they come and anoint the body? Now granted, it must have been a custom to apply certain spices and perfumes to a dead body when the person dies, as it is custom amongst the Jews and even Muslims to put some sweet smelling fragrance, like wash the body and make sure it doesn't have any bad smell, clean the body, and then maybe put a fragrance of some sort on it. Now, the issue that I have with the anointing of the body is that if we go according to Christian mathematics, we're not going according to our mathematics. I'll give you our mathematics after Christian mathematics. Christian mathematics, it's like the sign of Jonah. 3 days and three nights was Jonah in the belly of the whale. 3 days and three nights will the Son of Man be in the ground, all dead. So let's first look at the Christian mathematics. Christian mathematics, it's been 3 full days and 3 full nights. The smell of the body would be everywhere. The body would not be freshly smelling. It would start to have decayed. It would have not been smelling nice. Yet they were only going to come 3 days later to put perfumes and spices on. Not possible, not likely, never happened. It's not a custom. The Jews would not even touch a dead body once it had been dead for so long. So it's not going to happen, never happened. If we go according to real counting, what the rest of humanity does, not Christian counting, but everybody else in the world has different maths, it was 1 day and 2 evenings that they came back. Even then, 1 day and 2 evenings, they would still not have touched the body, because it's something they would not have done. The body would have already started to become not touchable. You had only one opportunity to do it. That's once the body had died, cleaned it, preserved it, and that's it. Done. So these religious women were particular in observing the Sabbath. If they were not particular in observing the Sabbath, they would have come the next day, which would have been Saturday. Or they would have been there that Friday night and would have dressed the body. So we know that these women were religious people. They would not have defiled themselves by handling a dead body, especially one that was already going through, as they thought, a putrefying state. Not ever, ever going to happen. Never. I can tell you now, those of you who are trying to pull the wool over people's eyes and say that they came back 3 days later or 1 day and 2 nights later, like the rest of the world counted, they would not have touched that body. That's the end of the argument. There's no more to the argument than that. Joseph and Nicodemus, Joseph of Arimathea, Nicodemus, had already applied ointment to the body, as we already saw previously in the episodes. They had already used a pound's weight of myrrh and aloe on the body already. So what's the purpose of applying more onto the body, especially one that would have been already putrefying? One that already started to decompose. No one had ever, and no one has ever, in Muslim custom or in Jewish custom, applied more ointment onto a corpse 3 days later or 1 day and 2 nights later. It has never been a custom, never will be a custom, never was a custom. And it was because perhaps they knew, and this is where we come with a more likely scenario. We are not saying we agree with this. We don't even believe this. In fact, none of us believe this. But it is more likely from the text than the explanation you have given, that Christians give in their explanation of this, that the body was alive. They knew it was alive. So they had already put ointment on the body with myrrh and aloe on the Friday evening. So they came to put more dressing onto the wounds to restore this body. And so they had bought more ointments to heal the body. There is no other reason that can possibly be explained that they would still bring other ointments and other treatments to the body, unless they expected to find the body still there to anoint it more so that it can heal more. This is the only explanation. The one that you are offering doesn't have bearing in history. It doesn't have bearing in any form of any experience in the past, present, or future in Jewish custom. But like we said, we do not agree with this. This is just a better explanation from the text than the one that you are offering. What about the unused ointment that is spoken about. Remember when we have the two accounts of Jesus, the oil that has been poured and given to him to wash his feet. One, it's washing his hair. The other one says washing his feet. And you can read that in John chapter 12, verse 3 to 7. And the other one is found, the other opposing view, in Mark chapter 14, verse 3. In John's gospel, it says that Mary took a pound of ointment and other spices and ointments and oils, costly, it says, very costly, and she washes or anoints his feet. And so this is the story, and Jesus says to her, keep this for the day when I am buried, when I die, and you can anoint me with it. This is what he says. So don't use that ointment. Don't waste this, all the ointment. Keep some of it for the day that I am buried. That's what he says. Yet, when we read Mark's version, Mark says it wasn't his feet that were anointed, but in fact, he washes his hair. So the one says it was the feet. The other gospel says washes his hair. So it's not that the story about her wiping the feet with hair. He anoints the feet. Other one anoints the hair. So they both speak about these expensive ointments that were kept. Both talk about the expensive ointments. Both say that these ointments were costly. Both accounts say that people there were disgruntled about the fact that there was such a waste on using these expensive ointments, and they should rather be kept for the poor and given to the poor, and the money used for the sick and the needy and the poor. Why did these women, according to that account that took place then, where Jesus said, don't waste it all, keep some of it for the day that I'll be buried, why do we see in the narration that's given now that they had to go buy spices, and why did they not use the ones that they already had? Simply because the time of the burying of Jesus, they had already used those spices, or they forgot they had those spices, or the gospel writers are simply making up the story as they go along and forgot about that story that they used earlier. So these sweet spices and the information about the spices was forgotten. Do you know when a bad writer writes, he forgets where he's going with his dialogue? I remember many years ago they brought out that film called Spider-Man. And on the internet, I haven't watched it, but when the film came out, there were hundreds of critics all over the internet writing, this was a mistake, that was a mistake, his reflection is going the wrong way, you can see the flag flying the wrong way, all these things, because the person who made the film didn't read his script properly. He didn't do his dialogue properly, so he missed out things. And so the critics had a field day. They found hundreds, well not hundreds, they found about 30 errors in the film. They were fatal errors, and that everybody was having fun about. Now, the same way, we find that the gospel is very similar. They forget the dialogue that they wrote earlier, and it's only when we read the text now that we go, what happened to those spices? Why did the woman have to go out and buy new spices? They already had spices and simple things. I know it's a small thing. It's a trivial thing, but it's important if we're looking if something is reliable or not, if the text is to be accepted or not. Now, the big question that we have to ask ourselves, why wait until Sunday anyway? Why didn't they just come out on the Saturday? Immediately, the apologists will say, well, these people were people who were pious. Didn't you just say yourself that these were women who would not come out because they were pious Jews? Now, if Mary of Magdala and her companions wanted to anoint the body of Jesus, then why did they wait until Sunday, which time the body would have started to decompose and putrefy anyway? Why did they not go out on the Saturday when the body was still in a better state, especially after the sun had gone down on a Saturday evening? Remember, the Sabbath was from sunset on a Friday until sunset on a Saturday, not sunrise on a Sunday. So they had the entire Saturday night to come out, torches and all, and anoint the body as they were supposedly, allegedly going to do. Christians would say that they were afraid of what the Jews would say. That's why they didn't come out there on the Saturday day. But there's nothing from stopping them coming out on the Saturday night. But this is the way that we see the text being written, it is not very well thought out or very smart in its writing. Now, people would have been out on the streets on a Sunday. On a Sunday, people would have been walking around the street. People would have seen what was going on the Sunday. They would have stopped the disciples. They would have stopped the Mary. They would have stopped whoever it was and said, "What are you doing? Why are you coming near this grave? Are you coming to steal the body?" Or if they had gone on a Saturday, no one would have seen, because all the Jews and all the people that you wouldn't want to see what was going on wouldn't be around, because they'd be keeping the Sabbath. They would have been indoors. They would have been busy with religious affairs. Now, granted, some of these disciples may have been devoted, pious, religious people. But remember, it was Jesus himself who broke the Sabbath on a number of occasions. Now, the Seventh-day Adventists will freak out because I just said that. Jesus himself didn't always keep the Sabbath. He healed people on the Sabbath. He said if an animal fell down the well, you could bring it out of the well. He said to people that you can heal somebody's body on the Sabbath. So we see him, remember when we look at John chapter 9, verse 14, where we see him restore the eyes of a blind man, that was done on a Sabbath. At the pool of Bethsaida in John chapter 5, he heals a person on the Sabbath, as well as a person's withered arm, he heals them on the Sabbath as well. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 12, he says out of his own mouth, "It is permissible to do good on the Sabbath." So when these women were coming to the body of Jesus on a Saturday, they would have been doing good on the Sabbath. So it was permissible for them to do it. Why don't they go? No one would have witnessed. No one would have saw what they were doing. It was more dangerous to go on the Sunday, when the people would have said, "What are you doing?" That would have been far greater a danger. Well, it's time for us to take a break. When we get back from the break, we'll continue, inshallah.
Most countries of the world ban bullying. They fight it in their schools and universities. A lot of us are being bullied differently every single day. Some come up to us and say, "Do this," while others say, "Don't you dare." Some say this is halal, while others say, "Nope, this is haram." Are you confused? Do you feel lost? Join me in Umdatul Ahkam, where, with the grace of Allah, we will learn the proper knowledge from the Quran and from the Sunnah, which would help stop this kind of bullying.
Join Asim Al-Hakim in Umdatul Ahkam, next on Peace TV.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back from the break. We are continuing with our look into the issues that happened during that fateful Easter weekend, as found in the pages of the Bible, or according to Christian understanding of what happened. So let's move on. Let's look at the recordings that we find in Matthew, as we find in Luke. We'll just look at those two now. We'll also find in John. All the Gospels, in fact, tell you. But we're going to look at what they say when they talk about these angels, or these apparitions, or these beings that appear at the tomb where Jesus was supposed to have been laid. Now, according to Matthew, the angel told Mary Magdala and her companions, as found in Matthew chapter 28, verse 7, "He has been raised from the dead and is going on before you into Galilee." So this angel tells these women who come to the grave, "He has been raised and is no longer dead. He's gone before you, and he will meet you and the disciples. Everyone must go to Galilee. That's where he will be." Now, Luke tells us in Luke chapter 24 and verse 4, he says, "Two men in dazzling garments appeared beside the tomb." So the first account is an angel. The second account, there were two men in dazzling clothes. Dazzling could mean anything. Could mean fashionable, could mean outrageous. It could have been cute. It could have been bad. Whatever it is, but whatever it was, it dazzled their attention. They were like, okay, that's what it means. Dazzling means that. Dazzling garments. Could mean anything. Whatever it means, dazzling garments. Then it says as well in John chapter 20, verse 12, that an angel appears. And then there is Luke's version, and Luke's version in Luke chapter 24, verse 5, it says, why do you seek the living amongst the dead? One has a young man, one has an angel, one has two angels, one has two men in dazzling clothing. So this is the story that we are told about in the New Testament. Not the same story. Remember, if we were at a football match, we should all agree on what teams were playing. If we're looking at the New Testament, we should all agree on who appeared at the tomb. Now, obviously, the spirit that inspired the secret of the creation of the New Testament was speaking in diverse tongues to diverse people in diverse ways, just like he is speaking to the New Testament believers that are living on planet Earth today. Otherwise, there wouldn't be 30,000 Christian denominations in the world. There'd just be one. So obviously, the spirit that was talking to inspire the New Testament of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and John is the same spirit that's speaking to the church today. And that's why there are 30,000 different denominations. And in those denominations, there are denominations. So there are splits within splits. So Mary Magdalene, the lady with the seven devils that we spoke about earlier, must have imagined these angels and thought of these angels and said, like, well, now that these angels have appeared to me, I should tell the rest of the disciples. Either she really saw them, or she had a vision, or she dreamt the whole thing up. She must have been very, very sure that when she tells the disciples, that these disciples will listen to what she says, and that they must go to Galilee, and they must meet Jesus there. She already knew of this Galilee rendezvous, because she had been told before the disciples met Jesus in his post-resurrected body, according to what we see in the text. So there was no need for more confirmation than this, because already she knew what she must tell them. So she tells the people, and of course, they don't believe anything that she has. And it says that none of them believed what she had to say, and they didn't believe that she was in her correct senses. So this is a story that we have. All of the disciples at this point are doubters, not just Thomas. You know, often we say people were doubting Thomas's. None of them believed. They wanted to see for themselves. Now, this same Mary of Magdala, she was known to be a woman who had these seven devils that had been driven out of her. And she must have imagined these angels, for the angels did not appear to any of the other disciples. She already knew about this Galilee rendezvous. So what she needed this angel to appear to her for is something that we don't actually know. So we don't actually know what this whole story is for. Jesus himself will tell them, you must meet me. Before he was even crucified, you must meet me in Galilee. I'll meet you all there. So there doesn't seem to be a point behind the reason for this angel to appear to her. There doesn't seem to be any point, in fact, I don't know how to put it any other way, for this angel to say that you must go to Galilee, because he already told them before he dies, they must go to Galilee and he will meet them there once he resurrects from the dead. And like I said, it is not only Thomas who was one of those particular people who said, I will not believe until I can verify the facts myself. The disciples are in exactly the same way. They did not believe. They thought everything these women said was nonsense. But oftentimes we find that Thomas has been criticized as being an unbeliever. And we would say to somebody, especially Christians love to say this to people, like, especially Christians who start to ask questions, and they ask questions of their pastor or their fellow parishioners in the church. The parishioners will say to that person, don't be a doubting Thomas. You must have faith and believe. Now, Thomas, like the disciples, like you, dear Christian, who is asking questions now and doubting Christianity, you are not doubting, you are pragmatic. This is what you are supposed to be doing. A religion that tells you to blindly believe without any evidence or substantiating facts behind it, either from the text or from external sources that agrees with the text or with science or with mathematics or with biology or with economics, then that religion is a religion that you should not be following, because that's a religion you're having to follow by blind faith. We are not supposed to be blind. We are supposed to have our eyes wide open. And this is the wonderful thing about the Quran. If you take it to a scientist, he goes, that makes scientific sense. If you take it to the mathematician, he says, that makes mathematical sense. If you take it to the biologist, he says, that makes biological sense. If you take it to the atheist, he says, that makes sense. If you take it to any of the sciences, whatever law, legal, whatever you can think of, I can't even think of them all, all of them will look at it and say, that makes sense. The Bible does not make sense through science, does not make sense through biology, does not make sense through mathematics ever, doesn't make sense through law, doesn't make sense through anything that you look at it, except through the eyes of Christianity. Because the eyes of Christianity say, we cannot prove it, you have to believe it by faith. And that's the only way the book makes any sense. It cannot handle scrutiny of science at all. Definitely none of the others that I've mentioned it can handle the scrutiny of. That's why we tell you, brothers, sisters, friends, doubters, pragmatists, look at the Quran. Not because I am telling you. We're not trying to steal people from Christianity and pull them over to Islam. Islam is a belief system based on facts. It's a belief system based on things that are credible, that can be seen and put under a microscope and analyzed and tangibly seen to be a bearing on reality. It's a common sense belief system. It's not a uncommon sense religion. So it's something that no matter how you look at it, it will still come out the exact same way. Where if you take the Bible, it always comes out more complicated, has to have more explanations, has to have another theory. Every day, Christianity has to rewrite itself. It has to reinvent its theories. The Jehovah Witnesses, don't even get me started with you guys. You've rewritten your doctrine hundreds of times since you started your religion. The Mormon Church is constantly changing its doctrines to fit the needs of the day. And don't get comfortable, Baptists and Anglicans and Methodists and Presbyterians, because you've done exactly the same thing. Your Apostles' Creed has changed how many times? Your belief systems have been written how many times? Your divisions and splits have taken place how many times? So this is a book that you can look at and you could pick up the writings of the scholars 1,000 years ago, 500 years ago, 300 years ago, 200 years ago about the Quran. All of those guys who put all their writings together, they'll all have the same thing to say about the Quran. We cannot find that even 10 years ago on any of the Christian denominations, because they're having to rewrite themselves for survival purposes. It's not because they are correcting anything in the book so it will make it easier for you to understand. They're correcting it for survival purposes. In South Africa, the World Council of Churches, something similar to that, have said that it is no longer a requirement to believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Why have they done that? For survival. Well, that's all the time we have for today's program. If you really want to find out what's really going to go on, make sure you tune in again next episode. Same place. So for me, Arib Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
pearls of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, reported Allah's messenger, may peace be upon him, as saying, verily, Allah likes three things for you, and he disapproves three things for you. He is pleased with you that you worship him and associate not anything with him, that you hold fast the rope of Allah and be not scattered, and he disapproves for you irrelevant talk, persistent questioning, and the wasting of wealth. Sahih Muslim, Volume 3, Book of Judicial Decisions, Hadith number 4255.
The value of money in the hereafter will be measured by its proper use in the present.
Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu anfiqoo mimma razaqnakum min qabli an ya'tiya yawmun la bay'un fihi wa la khullatu wa la shafa'a.
According to the glorious Quran, one of the best ways to use your money is to spend it in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by spreading His message of Islam. Peace TV is a non-profit Islamic satellite television channel that is primarily dedicated for just that cause, the proper presentation of Islam. It's a great choice to invest in it and a golden opportunity to purify your wealth in a way that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Support Peace TV. Send your zakat and donations to IRFI Al Rayan Bank, 47 Calthorpe Road, Birmingham, UK, B151TH. Pound account number 01132301. IBAN GB49ARAY 3000830113230 1. Sort code 300083. SWIFT BIC code ARAY GB22. Please confirm your contribution at support@peacetv.tv.
Support Peace TV, the solution for humanity.